invited talk. Let me quickly introduce the third speaker, Professor Eric Chance. I'm sorry, maybe my pronunciation wrong. He's from Ecole de Pont Polytech. So his main research interest is mathematical and numerical analysis of electronic structure model for quantum chemistry and material science. So he got Blaise Pascal Prize in 2009. And today he's going to talk about mathematical model and numerical method for electronic structure calculation. Please start.
So thank you for this kind of introduction. I'm very grateful. So I'm very grateful to the organizers for inviting me. It's a great pleasure and honor, and it also gives me the opportunity to advertise a field of research which gives rise to very exciting mathematical and numerical problems. So electronic structure calculation is in fact a very big business. It has a lot of applications in physics, chemistry, biology, material science, and nanosciences. Over 10,000 papers containing electronic structure calculation were published last year. This field utilizes about 15% of the overall CPU time available in scientific computing centers. And its importance for applied sciences were acknowledged by two Nobel Prizes in chemistry. The first one was awarded to Kohn and Popper for the contributions to the main two electronic structure calculation methods, that is density functional theory and wave function methods. And last year, Karplus, Leavitt, and Warshall shared, again, the Nobel Prize in chemistry for developing multi-scale models in which the finer scale is dealt with electronic structure methods. So the outline of my talk is as follows. I will first explain what first principle molecular simulation is about. I will then focus on the core problem in first principle molecular simulation. That is a calculation of electronic ground state. And then I will present some recent advances and open problems. Okay, so as I said, first principle molecular simulation has a lot of applications. It can be used, for instance, to discover new catalytic processes, to study crack propagation in materials, to do drug design, or also to predict the conductivity of molecular wire. Okay, this is a wire made of a single molecule. And as a matter of example, I will explain how to compute some physical and chemical property of a very simple system, a water molecule, using these techniques. Okay, so the idea is to just to observe that a water molecule, or any molecule, is nothing but an assembly of nuclei and electrons. So in the water molecule, we have one oxygen nucleus, two hydrogen nuclei, and 10 electrons. And these particles are in Coulomb interactions. We know how to write down the Coulomb interaction. And so we can use the fundamental laws of quantum mechanics and statistical physics. That is the first principle of these two fields. To compute, in theory, all the physical, chemical, or mechanical properties of this system. And a really nice feature of these models is that they do not depend on any empirical parameter specific to the system. Indeed, the only parameters in this model are a few fundamental constants of physics, so the reduced Planck constant, the electron mass, the elementary charge, the dielectric permittivity of the vacuum, the velocity of light, the Boltzmann constant, as well as the charges and masses of the nuclei. And these are very well known experimentally. So the charge of hydrogen is 1, the charge of oxygen is 8. Okay. And then the masses of the isotopes can be measured very accurately using mass spectroscopy. Okay, and as a result, we can compute the, all the property of the water molecule or any property of this very complex system from their chemical formula. But of course, we will see that it's not so easy. But we can notice that here the mass of the electron is much smaller than the masses of the nuclei. So we have a small parameter there, and we can use this small parameter to somehow decouple the electronic and nuclear dynamics. And so in our calculation of the property of the water molecule, we will use two steps. In a first stage, we will construct the so-called potential energy surfaces using electronic social calculations. And in a second stage, we will analyze these potential energy surfaces to extract some chemical and physical properties. Okay, so let me first focus on electronic social calculations. In the electronic social problem, we consider that the nuclei are clamped point-like particles, so we denote by RK their positions in space. And the goal is to compute the steady states of the n electrons in the electrostatic potential generated by the nuclei. So these steady states are solutions to the n-body Schrödinger equations. R1 here is the position in space of the first electron, and so on. This operator here, so it's a linear operator called the electronic Hamiltonian. And the first term models the kinetic energy of the electrons. This term models the interaction between nuclei and electrons. And again, this is the electrostatic potential generated by the nuclei. This term models the interaction between electrons. And from a physical viewpoint, E is the energy of the steady state. And the square of the modulus of psi provides the probability density of observing the first electron at R1, the second electron at R2, and so on and so forth. Well, electrons are fermions. In the first talk, we talked about bosons. Electrons are particles of different types. They are fermions. And because of that, the wave function must satisfy this anti-symmetry property, which is really a pain to deal with, but we have no choice. We really need to account for this constraint here. And you can easily see from the probabilistic interpretation of psi square that the norm of psi, the L2 norm of psi is equal to 1, and that the electronic density in the system, which is a physical observable, it can be measured by X-ray scattering, for instance. And so this electronic density is given by this formula. Okay? And to establish this formula, we also use the Pauli principle, the anti-symmetry. So the set of solutions to this equation can be obtained by studying the spectral properties of this operator, which I denote now from now on by Hn. Okay. This operator is a linear operator on the space of anti-symmetrized wave function. Okay, this is the anti-symmetrized tensor product of n copies of the one particle space. But in other words, this space is nothing but the set of square integrable functions of n variables satisfying this anti-symmetry condition. Then we know from Zeislin's theorem that for any neutral or positively charged system, this is the case for the water molecule, of course, we know that the spectrum of the electronic Hamiltonian has the following structure. It's always the same for all neutral or positively charged system. The operator is bounded below. Its essential spectrum is a half line, starting from sigma and going to plus infinity. And its discrete spectrum consists of an increasing sequence of eigenvalues accumulating at the bottom of the essential spectrum. We denote by Ek, the k plus first eigenvalue of Hn, the counting multiplicities. And so all these eigenvalues are functions of the nuclear positions. are parameters, the nuclear positions are parameters of this problem. So now we are in position to define the Born-Oppenheimer potential energy surfaces. We add to this eigenvalue the term which was missing in the electronic Hamiltonian, that is the interaction between nuclei. And we obtain in this way a sequence of increasing functions of the nuclear coordinates, which are called the Born-Oppenheimer potential energy surfaces. Of particular interest is the lowest one, and this is the ground state potential energy surface. I forgot to mention that the lowest eigenvalue is called the ground state, and the other eigenvalues are called the excited states. Okay, so now we proceed to the second step, which is the analysis of these potential energy surfaces. We will work in the framework of the Born-Oppenheimer approximation, which consists in doing first an adiabatic approximation, letting the ratio between the mass, the electron mass, and the mass of the nuclei go to zero, basically. And this adiabatic approximation is followed by a semi-classical approximation on the nuclear dynamics. But there are ways to go beyond this Born-Oppenheimer approximation. And the first thing we have to do is to search for the global minimum of W naught. Why? Because this global minimum corresponds to the stable configurations of the molecule. Okay, so for instance, for the water molecule, we know its equilibrium structure. It can be measured also experimentally using NMR measurements. And of course, in practice, we do not scan all this surface, okay? Because for a large system, this surface is of dimension, it's a function of dimension 3m, where m is the number of nuclei. And for a large system, there is no convenient way to sample this surface. So what we do is that we use local optimization or global optimization algorithms to locate the global minimum. Okay. Once we know the global minimum, that is the equilibrium geometry of the molecule, we can linearize the dynamics around this equilibrium geometry. We obtain a collection, we obtain a dynamical system, which is a kind of harmonic dynamical system. But the Hessian matrix is, however, degenerate because the system is invariant with respect to rotation and translations. And so this matrix is degenerate, and zero is, in fact, a six-fold degenerate eigenvalue. And but still, we have 3n minus 6 positive eigenvalues. And these positive eigenvalues correspond physically to the peaks in the infrared spectrum of the molecule, okay, so which can also be measured experimentally. So for water molecules, we have m equals 3, 3 nuclei, so we have 3 positive eigenvalues, and these eigenvalues correspond to the 3 different vibration modes of the water molecule. So the first one is the asymmetric stretch, okay, so it's something like that, okay, if you want. The symmetric stretch is this, and the scissor bend is that. Okay. And now, if we go to the higher part of the electromagnetic spectrum, the peaks we observe in the electromagnetic spectrum correspond to vertical excitations from the local minima of the various potential energy surfaces. Okay. And as we have several surfaces and several possible transition, we have a lot of peaks, and so these transitions are called vertical because there are the difference between this energy, for instance, and this one, which is on the same vertical axis. And the reason why only vertical transitions are allowed is because electronic processes are so fast that during electronic excitation, the nuclei, which are heavy particles, do not have time to move. That's why we have a vertical excitation. And so this allows to compute the visible spectrum of the molecule, that is its color, and also the ultraviolet and X spectrum, and also the ionization energy, which is nothing but the difference between this value and that value. We can also do chemistry with this Born-Oppenheimer energy surfaces. Indeed, the local minima of the Born-Oppenheimer ground state energy surfaces surface can be identified with the reactants and products of the chemical reactions. And the critical points of W with Morse index 1, that is a saddle point with only one negative eigenvalue, well, the action has only one negative eigenvalue, can be identified with the transition states from a chemical viewpoint. Okay. And once you know the reactants, the product, and the transition states, you can compute using the transition state theory, you can estimate at least the reaction rate, which is given by this formula. Here, EA is the activation energy, that is the difference between the energy of the transition state and the energy of the reactants. KBT is the Boltzmann constant, and T is the temperature, so this is the Boltzmann energy. And then the nu I ray are the eigenvalues, well, the vibration frequencies for of the reactants, and this one are the positive vibration frequency at the transition state. Okay, so we have an expression to predict the chemical rates of a chemical reaction. So I won't elaborate further on the analysis of the Born-Oppenheimer potential energy surface. This is a field in itself, and I will focus in this talk on the calculation of this Born-Oppenheimer energy surface. So I will focus on the ground state only, because that's in fact the most important in chemistry and material science. And so from now on, I will assume that I have a given molecular system, that the nuclear positions are fixed. And my goal is to solve this n-body Schrödinger equation. Okay. And actually, I don't need psi naught in applications. What we really need are the energy, E naught, because it's with E naught that I can construct this potential energy surface. And I will also need the electronic ground state, because with the electronic ground state, we can compute several properties of the molecule. And we can also, more importantly for numerical purposes, we can compute the gradient of the function W naught at a given point. Okay? And as the first step is to locate the global and the local minima, if I know the gradient, of course, it's very helpful. Okay. So this problem is of course difficult because we have a combination of three difficulties. The first one is that this is a high-dimensional problem, even for small molecules. Water molecule is a very small system. And nevertheless, I have 10 electrons, so I have a PDE in dimension 30, which is kind of high-dimensional. And if I have a bigger system, it's even worse. The particles are interacting with Coulomb interaction. I will come back to the specificity of Coulomb interaction later on. And the third difficulty is the fermionic nature of the electrons. I'm not. I need the wave function has to satisfy this antisymmetry property, and this is, as I said, it is difficult to handle this constraint. It's important to note that if you remove one of these difficulties, the problem becomes much easier to solve. For instance, if you do not account for this antisymmetry constraint, it's possible to solve this, to compute E naught very efficiently using, for instance, quantum Monte Carlo methods. This can be done, this is very efficient. But because of these constraints, quantum Monte Carlo methods are, well, they work well, but not as well as if we had bosons. Okay, and so one of the reasons why this problem is difficult is because it is multiscale in energy. Even though they are not large parameter or small parameters in this equation. And you can see that the relevant energy scales range over at least 8 orders of magnitudes. So let's try to understand that. So first, the energy of an individual atom scales as z to the 7/3. Okay? And z is the charge of the nucleus, so it's 1 for hydrogen, 2 for helium, and up to 92 for uranium. And so you can see that because of this law, which is a mathematical theorem, by the way, this can be proved mathematically, the energy of individual atoms go typically from 0.5 for hydrogen to 10 to the 4 or more for uranium. Let me mention that this power of 7/3 comes from the fact that we have fermions. We have the Pauli principle, and because of that, the electrons cannot gather in the ground state, and so they occupy shells. Okay? And this explains the scaling z to the 7/3. But in chemistry, we are not interested in the energy of individual atoms. We are interested in energy differences. Typically, in energy differences between reactants and products in a chemical reaction. And the energy produced by a chemical reaction is the difference between the sum of the energies of the reactants and the energy of the products. If we do this calculation for this simple chemical reaction, we obtain this number, okay, so it's typically 10 to the minus 1 atomic units, which is typically the energy of a covalent bond. And we see that if we make an error of, say, 1% on the energy of this guy, and if there is no compensation of errors between these two calculations, even the sign may be wrong. Okay? So it's not possible to do chemistry if you don't have the sign right. And if we go down in the energy scale, we see that the activation energy of photochemical reactions are about 10 to the minus 2, and that the accuracy required to do thermochemistry is typically the Boltzmann energy, 10 to the minus 3, because we have this exponential here. Okay? And so if we make an error larger than KBT, the exponential will be completely wrong. The exponential term will be completely wrong. And so we cannot predict anything. Okay, last thing, the van der Waals energy. So the van der Waals energy is the interaction energy between two atoms, two neutral atoms, which are not covalently bonded. The van der Waals energy decays are 1 to the r to the minus to the 6, okay, and this interaction, in fact, is not due to some polarization of the electronic density. Okay, it's not a classical effect due to polarization of the density. Indeed, if you have two hydrogen atoms which are far apart, they don't have any charge, any dipole momentum, any quadrupole, nothing. Okay, so it's not a problem of electrostatic. And to understand van der Waals energy, you really need to study the quantum correlations between the two electrons. And the reason why there is an interaction, an attractive interaction, is because the probability that the two dipoles are in the configuration where they interact attractively is larger than the probability that they interact repulsively. So we could wonder whether we should care about that, because this energy is much lower than this one, so maybe we don't care. But in fact, we do care, because it has been proved experimentally that van der Waals interactions are key to understand a lot of molecular processes in biology, but also, and it is not so well known, in material science. Okay, so now we can have maybe a very pessimistic view of the field, because I just told you that we have to solve high dimensional partial differential equation, and that we need to solve it with high accuracy. So maybe it's not possible. But in fact, it is, for reasons that are not completely understood, but physicists and chemists have developed a lot of methods to approximate the unbody Schrödinger equations, which can be classified in basically three main groups. So the first one is first group is wave function methods, among which the R3-Fock methods that you may have heard of. I will focus on the Concha model, which belongs to the class of density functional theory. This model is the most popular to date. And but let me also mention quantum Monte Carlo methods, which are very interesting to study mathematically and numerically, and which could outperform DFT if some problems are solved. Okay, just to small example to show you that we actually can predict the properties of molecules using this approach. So let's come back to the water molecule. If I remove the translation and rotation degrees of freedom, I can represent the geometry of the water molecule by three scalar quantities. The bond distance between the oxygen and the hydrogen, and the bond angle. And the equilibrium geometry of the water molecule will be obtained by minimizing this, this function. These are the experimental data obtained by NMR. And this is what you get with this method, which is called coupled cluster single double triple, which is a kind of spar tensor approximation of the full n-body Schrödinger equation, usually speaking. And you see that indeed the results are pretty good, that's pretty impressive. Because to remind you that to obtain this result, we have to solve PDE dimension 30. And this is what you get with the DFT method and with the Concham GGI functional. GGI is here. And you can see that maybe I'm not as accurate as in CCSDT, which is considered as a gold standard in chemistry, but still the results are pretty good. Okay, so here are the Concham equations that many people try to solve. This is the electronic ground state density, rho naught, and rho naught is obtained as a sum of the square of the function phi I for I going to 1 from 1 to n, n is the number of electrons in the system, and the phi I as orthonormal eigenvectors associated with the lowest eigenvalue of this operator here. This operator is called the Concham Hamiltonian. It's the sum of two terms, so minus a half Laplace, plus a multiplicative operator, which is called the Concham potential. And the Concham potential is itself the sum of the Hartree potential. The Hartree potential is nothing but the electrostatic potential generated by the total density of charge, electronic minus nuclear density of charge. And VXC is called the exchange correlation potential. So it has been proved by Hohenberg and Kohn, and then by Kohn and Cham, that there exists an exact exchange correlation potential, meaning that there exists a potential depending only on the ground state density, so that if you solve this equation, you obtain the same ground state density and the same energy as if you you solve the full n-body Schrödinger equation. So this is a very important result from theoretical results. The problem is that this potential is not known and that it has to be approximated. And the reason why you have many Concham models, in fact, you don't have only four, you have plenty, maybe 100. And the reason why you have plenty is that many people have tried to approximate this potential with good physical insight or chemical insight. And okay, and so you can see that this problem is an elliptic eigenvalue problem, okay, but a non-linear one because the operator depends himself on the eigenvectors through the density. So now if you have a very big system, say with 1 million electrons, you don't want to solve you don't want to compute all the individual eigenvectors. Okay, you don't want to deal with a million wave function in phi I. Okay? So, but fortunately, there is a way to rewrite this equation in such a way that you can get rid of the phi I. So this can be done as follows. We introduce this quantity. So this is obviously a tautology, but we introduce the operator with kernel sum of phi I of r, phi I of r prime star. Okay. And this kernel is nothing but the kernel of the orthogonal projector on the eigenvectors corresponding to this eigenvalue. Okay. So this can be written as follows. Rho naught is, so to speak, the diagonal part of the kernel of the spectral projector of this operator on the range minus infinity epsilon f. Okay. And using Cauchy integral formula, I can rewrite this the density as follows. So here I use Cauchy integral formula, integrate over this circle in the complex plane. And now I have I have to compute the diagonal part of the kernel of the resolvent of the operator. And this can be done with very efficient techniques of linear algebra, because there are ways to compute the diagonal part, the diagonal component of the inverse, without computing the inverse of the whole matrix. Okay, so now let me present briefly some recent advances and open questions. Let me first with a purely theoretical result, very problem, but very interesting one, which has to do with infinite quantum systems. Okay, because if you take a piece of matter like that, it contains 10 to the 20 or more atoms. Okay, and maybe it's, if you consider a crystal. Okay, it's better to, instead of dealing with 10 to the 20 atoms, it's better to deal with an infinity of atoms. Because if you have a perfect crystal, you can take advantage of the periodicity of the system to speed up the calculation, to make the calculation possible. Okay, so the problem of bulk limit is the following. So we have a model for a finite number of atoms and a finite number of electrons. This is n-body Schrödinger equation, but in a perfect crystal, perfect crystal is an infinite system, and nobody knows how to write down a Schrödinger equation for an infinite number of fermions. Okay, nobody knows how to do that. So the best we can do is to say, okay, let's proceed as follows. We take a cluster by putting a finite number of atoms cube like that. Okay, so we put the nuclei on the lattice sides of a cubic lattice, for instance, and we compute the ground state energy and the ground state density, and then we let L go to infinity. So the question, natural question, are: so first, does the ground state energy per atom as a limit? Does the ground state energy density converge? If it does it converge to a periodic density? An additional question with a lot of practical interest is, can we compute this density by solving a simple problem or a collection of simple problems set on the unit cell, maybe with periodic boundary conditions? And an additional question called the Christian-Cruissal problem is even more difficult. So far, I have clamped the nuclei on the lattice sites. What about if I let the nuclei relax to their equilibrium position before letting L go to infinity? Do we recover a crystal in the limit? So this is a very nice problem. People think, well, physicists think that it is true, but the mathematical proof is probably extremely complex. So here are the results which are obtained on this crystal problem. So it has been proven by Pfefferman that the answer to the first question is yes. A simpler proof has been provided by Einzel, Levin, and Solovej a few years ago. For density functional models, so let me come back here. So for all these kind of models, Thomas Fermi and Concham models, we know more. In particular, we know that for at least for some of them, the answer to the first four questions is yes. Okay. On the other hand, for the crystal problem, very little is known, apart from a result by Blanc and Lebris. For the one-dimensional version of the Thomas Fermi van Weizsäcker, nothing is known. And these problems are probably very difficult. Okay, this was for perfect crystals, but perfect crystals do not exist in nature, and in fact, they are not so interesting in practice. What physicists really care about are crystals with defects. So, in real life, crystals have defects such as vacancies, an atom is missing, interstitial atoms, impurities. There are also dislocations or grain boundaries. And these defects, even if their number is very small, are responsible for a lot of macroscopic properties of the crystal. For instance, in doped semiconductors, even if the doping rate is very small, 10 to the minus 4, 10 to the minus 5, all the electronic properties of the system are governed by the defects. So, with Mathieu Levine and a PhD student of us, Amélie de Laurence, and then with Virginie Arlacher, we tried to understand if it was possible to use the thermodynamic limits arguments for the case of single local defects. So, of course, if you consider the energy per atom for a crystal with defect, it converges to the same thing as for the crystal without defect if you just put one defect. So the thing to do is to compute the energy of the cluster with a defect and subtract the energy of the crystal without defect, so it's a kind of renormalization, and then let L go to infinity. And so we prove with that this technique works, and that we can define in this way an energy per for the energy of the defect and the density of the defect. Then later, still with Mathieu Levine and with another student of us, we tried to do the same for a crystal with a random distribution of defects. And it turns out that it is much more complex. And actually, we are not able to do that for the Coulomb interaction. We only are able to do that for short-range interactions. At least to pass through the thermodynamic limit. We were able to define a Concham model for randomly distributed defect and disordered materials, but we are not able to prove that it was the thermodynamic limit of finite systems. And then there are lots of open problems. Nothing is known for the case of metals, for excited defects, and so on. So there are lots of problems. And in particular, physicists are very interested in simulating charge defects in solids, and this is an open problem basically in their community. The third topic is about the calculation of macroscopic properties from microscopic description of the system. So here also we have a few results. The first results were obtained by Blanc, Lebris and Lyons and are concerned with the elasticity of weakly deformed crystals within the Thomas Fermi van Weizsäcker model. With Mathieu Levine and then with Gabriel Stoll, we studied the static and dynamical dielectric properties of insulators. And we proved rigorously the Adler-Weiser formula giving the macroscopic dielectric permittivity of crystals from Concham models, from first principles. There are also some works by Wenland and John Fenglow. But also in this field, there are a lot of open problems, how to take temperature into account, how to deal with mathematical properties, defects, and multi-scale materials such as polycrystals. The next topic is about model reduction. If you take, in particular, this is very useful in particular in drug design. So if you do a drug design, so this is typically a drug, and which will interact with a protein, which is not represented here, And so this system is huge. Okay, a drug is usually a small molecule, but a protein is a very big molecule with several thousands of atoms. And then you need also to account for water, because water plays an extremely important role in these processes. And so, in principle, you could apply all this approach to the whole system, to the super molecule. But as the size of the super molecule is too big, maybe several hundreds of thousands of atoms, it's not possible to do that. And the best you can do is to simulate the drug with the full quantum chemistry description with high accuracy, simulate as well the active site of the protein with the same high accuracy model, and then model the rest of the protein using molecular dynamics, and then model water using this kind of implicit solvent model. So implicit solvent model may seem very crude. What you do is that you replace all the water molecules with a macroscopic media, an effective macroscopic media, with the dielectric permittivity equal to the macroscopic dielectric permittivity of water. But it turns out that this model worked pretty well. And so there are long histories, date back to Born, Capwood, and Onzager. But they are widely used today. So with some colleagues, and it was a collaboration with chemists, Filippo Riparini and Benedetta Minucci, and mathematicians, Yvon Vadé, Benjamin Astal, and myself, we were able to design what we think to be a very efficient numerical method to solve this equation and couple it to the Concha model. But there are many things to do on this kind of models. We would like to, we started to work on the mathematical derivation of these effective models from first principle, but it is quite difficult. And I mentioned earlier the Nobel Prize in Chemistry obtained last year by Karplus, Levitt, and Warshall. And they get their Nobel Prize for developing models in which you couple a quantum mechanical model, molecular mechanics, so classical molecular mechanics and implicit solvent model to study biological molecules, which is with application in drug design in particular. But I would say that I think it's fair to say that nothing is known mathematically on these models. Okay, we don't have a clue why they should work, how to obtain them using rigorous mathematical arguments. Okay, this will be my last slide before conclusion. This time, this problem is concerned with numerical analysis and error estimators. So in this business, we have a very good reference model, the embodied Schrödinger equation, and we want to compute a quantity of interest, which is, for instance, the rate of a chemical reaction. We are not able, usually to simulate the full embodied Schrödinger equation, so we need to resort to an approximate model, such as the Concha model. Then we need to discretize it, solve it with iterative algorithms, then write a code and run the code. And at each step, of course, we make errors. Okay? So for instance, here, when we use iterative algorithms, we need to use a stopping criteria to stop the calculation at some point. Okay? And so the overall error we make depends on the input parameters, but also on all the choices we made along the way. And if we make a 20% error here, there is no point in trying to be extremely accurate there. Okay? And so the goal is to balance the error between these different sources of errors. Okay? So this is a very ambitious project. So far, we are very far to do that fully, but with Geneviève Dusson, Yvon Madé, Benjamin Stam, and Martin Voralik, we made a first step in this direction. We were able to fully understand the approximation error for Concha model, for the plane wave discretization of Concha model, and to balance these two sources of errors for some specific algorithms. Okay, so we are very excited about that, and we plan to devote a lot of effort in this direction in the future. Okay, so it's time to conclude. So I show you that first principle molecular simulation have a lot of applications in various fields, and they give rise to a wide variety of interesting and modeling mathematical numerical problems. And I would like to emphasize that these problems are of very different natures. Okay, and that's also why I didn't state so much theorems, and I didn't talk too much about the methods. It's because there are many, many, many. Okay, and so I've been pointless to focus on just one. Okay, I prefer to give you a broad overview of the field and show you that these techniques are related to many fields in applied mathematics, even some very abstract ones, for instance, to model topological insulators, new materials earlier. And to do that, you need to use chain classes, okay, which are tools used by our colleagues in algebraic topology, and also to model disorder systems, you need sister algebras and this kind of advanced mathematical tools. Okay, so thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for a very nice talk. So other questions?
It was present here only implicitly Pauli principle. Can you include it into the formalism, which would be probably needed if you speak about topological insulators?
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for your question. Yeah, so I didn't mention spin for the sake of simplicity, but of course, the wave function psi naught is not only a function of the positions of the particles, but also of their spin. Okay, and in fact, what you have to do is to replace this space by the space L2 of R3 with value in C2 to account for the spin. So of course, this is extremely important, and in fact, all the numerical results are presented have been obtained with model with spins. Otherwise, So of course, spin is extremely important, for just for the purpose of simplicity that I didn't mention that.
When you do random dislocation, do you see some kind of Anderson localization?
So for dislocations.
Random.
Yeah. I don't know. In fact, even for point defects, with these interacting models, it's not so clear that you have the same kind of Anderson localization as for non-interacting. What you observe in for non-interacting models, and we with Salma Labbabi and Mathieu Levin we run a few simulations, but on model problems, and it was not clear numerically that you have the same kind of Anderson localization for Concha. So yes, probably a very difficult question. Very, very interesting, very difficult.
Okay, so are there any other questions? So let's thank the speaker for now.